The other possible gate adder, of course, some I will show you can read. These are fundas, and therefore I thought maybe you should look into them seriously. Here is another gate which is called transmission gate adder, and we all know the transmission gates logic per se, CPL as it is called, complementary pass logic, or just pass transistor logic, as least transistors, okay, because it does not use normal NAND NORs directly. It essentially uses muxes in some way. So here is a transmission gate adder. One of the some part requires your XOR. So I have shown you an XOR circuit. It is very interesting. You can see from here. This is your transmission gate. P channel device parallel to N channel device. This is your transmission gate. Then you have a inverter like structure made of P1 and N1. Essentially it is also transmission gate, but essentially you can see it is like behaving here as an inverter. Okay. The upper drain source of this P channel is connected to the input A. Please take it, the source of P channel is connected to input A, and the source of this N channel is connected essentially to the output of this and to the gate of N2. The P2 gate is also driven from A input. Now you say why I did this. Of course, you can see, if you implement, you will find very clearly. Let us say A is 0 and B is 0, and you expect output to be 0. So if A is 0, this transistor is on. Okay. So this node is 1. Okay. If this node is 1, N2 is on. Okay. I repeat, if A is 0, this P channel is on, VDD comes here, 1 appears, N2 turns on. Okay. However, if you look at B, which is 0, this P1 turns on. Okay. P1 turns on, but this voltage is 0. Please take it, A is 0, so the source voltage of P1 is 0. Okay. Input is also 0. Okay. P channel will be on, but the node, it will go to 0. If this node goes to 0, obviously even if this is on, B is also 0, so it transmitted through this 0, it also came 0, so no contention. The worry was contention, no contention. Both sides, I am stabilizing 0, so the output goes to 0, which is my A XOR B for 0. Take one, at least one more. A is 1 and B is 0, and I expect output to be 1. So if A is 1, N channel is on, okay. This is 0, N2 is off, okay. N2 is off. Now come back, if A is 1, the drain source of this P1 is VDD, okay. Since B is 0, P1 is on. If P1 is on and this is VDD, this is VDD, this is VDD 1. Since this was 1, P2 is also off. Please take it, N2 was off because it is 0, P2 is 1, gate is 1, so it is also off. So B is not influencing output now, it is only from this I got my VDD, so no contention. Okay. So I got 1. Okay. So how many transistors? 8 transistors. So you have, by this is an XOR, same way other ABBC functions is implemented here, shown here. So by using 4 transmission gate, 4 inverters, 2 XOR gates, an adder can be constructed, which is shown here. So what is the advantage? We characterize this, of course it will require area, so many transistors, 24 transistors. However, it has equal delay for both sum and C. Okay, so that is very good, it is equalizing the delays. Okay. This is same operation. If you use, this is AA bar, this is CCI bar, this is my XOR, and this is my sum generation, and this is my carry generation. Symmetric circuit, very important, symmetric circuit. All times designers must see that their layout is symmetric, and to make layout symmetric, make your schematic symmetric, because only then layout will be symmetric. Taking the same cube, we went further. We said, okay, if you can use carry transmission gates, pass gates, so instead of using ABC, I can now use G's and P's which we have, or G and D's, and I can generate both carry and sum. So here is a carry generation. I have a input CI which is passing through a transmission gate under control of PI. This is generation bar, which is essentially delete, okay, and GI bar, and this is delete. Now let's see what happens. If PI is 1, we know GI is 0. Always, please take it. If P is 0, P is 1, G must be 0. A XOR B is something 1, A B must be 0. Okay, that's XOR equation. So if A is, if P is 1, this is on, P is 0, PI bar is 0, so this N channel is on, P channel is on, N channel, CI is entering. CI is entering. So C0 is CI. That's the function we wrote. G plus PCI, if P is 1, G has to be 0, CO is CI, transmitted. So you can see. Now if CC, let's say P0 is 0. If P0 is 0, the pass gates, full pass gate is off, P channel is off, N channel is on, because PI is 0 means PI bar is 1, both P and N channel off, no carry can enter. Now look at it. If GI is 1, that is GI bar is 0, now carry is G. We know if P is 0 means carry is G. So if G is 1, that is A equal to B, 1, then GI bar is 0. If GI bar is 0, P channel turns on, VDD appears, which is 1 transferred. By same logic, if A and B are 0, then this will turn it on, this will pull down, C0 will go 0. This is essentially what this word Manchester carry did. Then we figured out that this is a static circuit in some way, but not used in a static mode. So why do I use two pass transistor? Instead, I'll use that in series of this and use dynamic gate. If you do that, this is some kind of a partial latch, I can say. And I use that trick of latching where I can block the output by one pass gates. So I use that and then I say, okay. Now the only thing trick is I have to buy input CI bar, and we know how to create bars. Every such case actually you create bars, so you don't worry too much getting bars. Okay. You have 5 these are P channel N channel device which are clocked with 5, and you have generate signal here. Now one can see if PI is 1, this is on. So whatever is CI bar is transferred to C0 bar, that is CO is CI. That's what we always say, when the P is 1, C0 should be CI. Okay, so that is transferred. If P is 0, we know CG. Okay, so no carry is entering. P is 0 means N channel off, no carry enters. Now we look at it, if phi is 0 initially, this node is pre-charged to 1. This node is pre-charged to 1. Because this N channel is off, okay, this P channel is on, this N channel is off. When I evaluate, phi goes high, this phi is also goes high, so P channel turns off, and now this transistor is on. Depending on GI, that is AB is 0 or AB is 1, okay, this transistor will be on or off. If GI is 0, this will remain VDD pre-charged. That's what bar you wanted, carry bar. Okay, so you have obtained it. If you expect GI to be 1, that means AB is 1, then this transistor will turn on. This is anyway on. This will pull down to 0, which is the opposite of 1 anyway has occurred for you. So this is called dynamic implementation of Manchester's carry. Essentially, they are all dynamic gates, clock gates. They actually have their own problems, but I think my course should not look into those problems right now. Okay. Okay. So if I now connect number of them, 4 bits, 8 bits, 16 bits, any number, all upper P channels are gates are connected, all lower N channels gates are connected to phi, both sides like this. This is my CI 0 first, and remember only difference between the first case is a CI bar you have to substitute. And you can see here, depends on A and B, that is P, either C, whichever you expect will come. This will act like an input for the next, and you are actually taking this output immediately as inverted output as C0, C1, C2, C3. And you can now keep propagating your carry, depends on whether A and B are what, depends on A. These are 4 bits A0, B0, A1, B1, A2, B2, A3, B3 and An, Bn, An minus 1, Bn minus, any numbers. Okay. It's chain. But this looks very simple, nice, everything is nice. So if you see its delay, this formula, probably I don't know how many of you still remember, it's called Elmore's theory. It assumes right now that P channel is a resistance, obviously, because passing some current, it is like resistance. And all these transistors, their inputs are at the capacitive. So we say it's like a RC network. Okay, this transistor is parallel to this at this node. So all are, so you can see, this is a RC transmission like network, and using Elmore's theory, typical time constant associated with this is 0.69 n into n plus 1 times R and C is for each, this is R and C, okay, by 2 averaging because extra stage. So n plus n plus 1 by 2 into RC. Now one can see from here, in this case we have assumed as if things are going very well. Okay, this is what I say, more technology, more worries. I mean, as I say, 60-year-old person has worries. You may not have. Okay, you may actually enjoy doing it. Okay. Flip flop. Okay, so if I see delay from here, one clearly sees that as the bit size increase, the delay will increase because there are so many. If in a transmission line the number of RCs are too high, that Elmore's theory says it keeps multiplying. That means this is not very ideal, though it looks very good for implementation because it looks so simple to implement. Okay, so we say, okay, this is good. We didn't say much on this. Okay, I can reduce probably R and C by choice of the transistors I use, both P channel and N channel. I can actually put minimum size, larger size, but once I put a larger size for R and C, if I put this larger for good drive, you see, remember I am to driving a huge line, so I need a larger transistor, larger channel, larger capacitor. So I may reduce R by increasing size, but I may increase the capacitance. If I reduce the capacitance by reducing the size, then I increase the resistance. So essentially RC is never improving in any such systems. Okay. So if larger N, anyway you are spoiling. Further, the length depends on the bit width you have. You have a large delay coming from wire. Okay, it may actually exceed all other delays. So worry starts, how to do that. Okay, essentially for a VLSI one can always see the wire delay will be always smaller if the width of that line is larger, resistance will be smaller. So all the time whichever line is running for smaller R you expect, the wire resistance should be reduced if you can widen that out. But widen has another problem. The capacitance which you will get also will enhance. So the you need not use normal oxide. If you have a low K dielectric, as what we do in interconnects, use those. So never use the first interconnect line for any such RCs. Go on the higher levels and you may improve your R and C. Of course, there is an additional R coming through VR, but that may not be offsetting too much. This is the implementation. This is what I just now said, capacitance per node on a carry chain equal to 4 diffusion capacitance, 1 input capacitance from inverter and 1 wire, and wire is the major capacitance someday you will find as the lower technology starts. That is why if you have heard today or yesterday, major worry in VLSI design is not on so much on gates but more on interconnects. Okay, so it's now the new word has appeared, they call interconnect aware designs. You should be aware of interconnect more than anything else. We use this trick slightly in a different form. This, I said fine. I can now use another adder in which I may actually skip the carry. Okay. Now this is normal ripple carry adder shown here, 4 bits. This has inputs P0, G0. This is P1, G1, P2, G2, P3, G3. That is A0, A1. A2, A3, B0, B1, B2, B3 kind of inputs. Okay, so what essentially this ripple carry we did, we say okay, we are just, that is I keep saying that formula is always in my mind. C0 is G plus PCI. Okay. So, I say if P is 1, G is 0, G is 1, P is 0, that I know very well. So, I figured out A XOR B, A0 XOR B 0, A1 XOR B, I know all P0, P1, P2, P3 a priori because I will actually generate them. Okay. If I have that value known and if all of them are 1, I know the it is only if P is 1, G is going to be 0 anyway and whatever is the carry I am pushing, that is the carry I am going to get. So, I used whatever this 4 bit adder, I added another line connected to a multiplexer. Okay. This is the carry which is may be generated in other cases when P0, P1, one of them is not 1. So, I have a 2 muxes and I have a select which is product of P0, P1, P2, P3. So, if any one of the P0, P1, P2, P3 is 0, which was selected? The upper one will be selected. That means you are actually carrying through your this, which is a normal carry generations. But in case there is a case when P0, P1, P2, P3 all are 1s, this lower is selected for the mux and lower is the input, so transmit. Okay. So, it automatically at least some part of the circuit where your input data is such that P0, P1, P2, P3 are 1s, you do not have to generate C's anyway and directly pass, and this C is available to you for the next stage even before sums are calculated for these full adders, okay, because it is bypassing all of them. Okay. No timing is required for this full adder calculation of C if P0, P1, P2, P3 are 1s. However, if they are not, then the normal calculations need to be performed. The trick we use then, we say okay, if you have a very large amount of bits adding to do 16 bit, 32 bit, 64 bits. So, I said okay, what I will now do since I have to use muxes, I break those number of n bits word which is I am going to use into m blocks. So, I have m part of n. So, let us say in this case m is 4. Okay, I use 4 bits, m is 4 and let us say I have a total of 16 bits. So, I now 4 blocks required. For each block 4 bits. So, I have for 16 bits, I need 4 blocks repeatedly. Please take it, this part is same as what I showed earlier. So, I said the first thing is, let us see what is the total adder time. Let us look for the critical path. Okay, the critical path starts from, you have to generate A0, B0, you must get A0, B0, CI minus 1. Of course, CI is coming here and then you generate P and G. That is called setup. Setup means generation of P and G is called setup. So, I generated, so there is some time I will spend in actually generating P and G. So, that is called setup time. Then using that setup P0, G0 on the 4 bits which I did just now, 4 adders, I add carry. Okay, and I see if any one of the input is 0, P is 0, then it will pass through this propagation. If not, it will pass through the other side and be available to me. So, I have a time. If this directly passes, there is hardly any time. But this time plus mux time is being used by me to generate the next C. Okay. Then by same logic, when I get to here or here, I am using this block. But here the setup time is not required. Why? Because when I was setting them, all I have set. So, I am not putting any additional time in setting P1, P2, C1, G2, anyone. Okay. So, what is the critical path? Setup time, then this is that bypass part, whatever is the this. There is a carry. Carry, whatever the time taken for carry, that part is in worst case. Let us say none of them are passing through directly and all have to do. So, you need that much. And since there are m bits, m times each of them will require time. So, m times t carry plus there will be time for mux, which I say is a mux, this is called bypass. Bypass is essentially mux time, time to pass through a mux. Okay. Please take it, this time plus time for a mux, and since there are n by m minus 1 muxes, because 1, 2, 3 are required, 4th I do not need to get the sum, final sum. I repeat. I don't need 4 muxes, I need 1, 2 and 3 to get the sum. The next mux I am not using for this side. So I need only n minus, n by m minus 1 only. So I say m carry plus m minus 1 t carry, which is the other side of this, plus, sorry, not m, this is the n by m minus t bypass. Now this carry is generated for each of them. Each of them. So you have to add that worst. Please remember, this is a worst case calculation. Not that every time this may happen. Many a times you may actually go like this. So you will be speed up, but design has to be for worst cases. Okay. Plus the sum time which come here. So the net time is this, and this also shows larger the number of n, larger is delay. But at least it is not. It is also can be divided by m. So if I choose my m blocks properly, I don't know how much increase in t carry I will get, because depends on m and n choices, I can optimize the delay little better. I repeat, I have two parameters to optimize, n and m. So I adjust the two so that I get minimal delay. Okay. So if I compare carry ripple versus carry bypass, putting all others time as equal, all equal, t sum is equal to t carry equal to, everyone is say minimal, then I plot bypass time versus n, bypass adder time versus n and by ripple adder. So you can see they intersect at some point. Of course that depends on the other values, but for one value of equal I have chosen, or rather Rebe has chosen, you find somewhere here around 4.8 or 5, they cross. What does it tell? If your bit size is smaller than 4, use ripple carry. Okay. If it is more than 4, go for this bypass adder. So this, when to use when. So of course this number may not be exact, because the other values will decide where it will cross over. But the idea is to show that you can find some optimum below which you should always use ripple carry, above which you can use bypass. The third possibility is select, carry select. All that time you are using, that carry may be 0 or carry may be 1, and so depends on 0 or 1 you were transmitting something. So I said, okay, here is another game I can play. I say, okay, I generate my P and G as usual. And I actually calculate carries, both assuming input carry either 0 or 1. There are only two possibilities. So I do calculation a priori, assuming either it will be 0 or it will be 1. For given P0, G0, P1, G1, whatever it is, I will assume both possibilities and I will calculate them, both of them. And then I will connect them both to a multiplexer. And depending on the actual carry I get, I may either choose this or choose this. Okay. So I saved some time. This is a priori operation. Okay. So I said, okay, I can select my carry, and selection is essentially from this, and then finally some can be obtained and final new carry can be generated. Now if you see same 16-bit adder for carry select, this is again same operations, okay, no difference. Now you have to, what is the critical path now? You have set up 0 carry, 1 carry, multiplexer, then this multiplexer and sum. So there can be two possibilities. One is that I choose M, which is say 4, 4, 4 equal. Okay, there are 16 bit, I made 4 blocks. Okay, 0 to 3, 4 to 7, 8 to 11, 12 to 15, 4 blocks. The other possibility is, I may choose some other number. First 2 bits, next 3 bits, next 4 bits, next 5 bits, kind of this. I keep increasing bits as I progress. Okay. Of course, you can see you will need some additional blocks in most cases, but that is a part. So now if I use this kind of architecture in which I want to know whether now the delays are different. One method is equal m's, alternate next is m, m plus 1, m plus 2, m plus 3, m plus 4. If I do this calculations, for the first case, it is setup time n by m times t plus t carry plus t sum as usual. Okay. However, if I do different bits 2, 3, 4, 5 like this, I have a net n is m plus m plus 1 plus m plus p minus 1, p stages, p are the stages. Earlier n by m is, was known, now I am not saying same, m is varying now, okay. M, m plus 1, m plus 2, mp plus minus 1, and if I expand that, the series sum of this is p square by 2 plus pm minus half. This is a standard series sum, this is a series. And if I see very carefully that if n are very, very large, this roughly becomes p square by 2, p square by 2. This term is then very small, or we say p is root 2n. So the stages now you have, which you have is, earlier how many it would have been? N by m stages. Now it is root 2n. And if I now write the again same expression for time, it is t setup mt carry plus root 2n into mux time plus t sum. In earlier case, in linear, it is n by mt mux. You can see now the lower one, t add, is proportional to n. The upper one is proportional to root of n. This is kind of logarithmic system I created, and therefore I can reduce the, I mean improve the speed or reduce the time. So if I do this equivalent again, I have, so you can see from here, if n is very, very high, square ones almost tapers down, it remains constant. So if I have a 64-bit processing something is doing, always choose square root kind of things, that is you used increasing this. However, the hardware is higher, as you said, yes, but that is the penalty I paid to improve my speed. Otherwise use linear if it is little lower, and if it is much lower, 4 bits or something, still use ripple carry. The last of them, look ahead. All this problem we looked into point of view that you have to generate carry and it has to propagate carry. So we came out with an idea that look at our functions. Maybe I think this second sheet can be better. Okay. Just don't see figure right. That's what I say, my hand-drawn figures are something like that, you know. Okay. Okay, so if you see the carries, okay, the first carry is G1 plus PC0. C0 is input carry. Next time if you see, it is G2 plus P2 times C1. P2 times the last carry. But C1 I know, what is G1 plus PC0. So I substitute in the second my C1 term and I expand it, so I get C2 is G2 plus P2 G1 plus P1 P2 C0. Okay. If I see C3, it will be G3 plus P3 times C2. So I put C2 again in that function, okay, and I again expand it. So I get G3, P3, G2, P2, P3, G1, P2, this, and as many carry blocks you have. So if you see your last carry part from a block, do you see you actually, normally what did I say? The initial carry is normally 0. Initial carry of a first adder is normally 0. So you can see the final carry generation is almost independent of the carry you are actually having it. So all that you have to generate is GP, GPs, okay, and if you can generate them one after the other, then you have a situation in which you can generate C, C, C1, C2, C3, C4 without actually having full knowledge of CI. If you have a CI, I mean one calculation is there, but most times you may find you have generation is very fast. You are not depending on the last carry. Please remember, you are not depending on propagation of the carry, you are actually looking ahead of the carry itself. So okay, here is the output carry is related to GK plus PK, GK minus, and series of them, you can keep expanding them till CI minus 1, that is the last input carry. This can be implemented by simply this kind of circuit. You have 4 P channel devices here, 4 N channel devices here, all N channel receives P0, P1, P2, P3. All P channels here receives G3, G0, G1, G2, G3, and this in between these two receives input carry. Okay. Now we can see, depends on you know, this implementation is not very good, but just to get an idea, 4 transistor here, 4 transistor here, if you have more more bits on that, how many series transistor you will see? 4, 5, 6, this, and all such systems will be always slower, because you said by reducing this look ahead, we don't want to propagate, we saved the time. So ideally we did, but in real life, if you see a CMOS structure, your capacitances will be so high that essentially your logical effort went up. Okay. So this ideal thinking, what the formula shows, is not really valid if I really see implementation. The way I will implement is this in a domino. I have this upper p-channel transistors here, and you can have multiple n also, but I have shown one. This should be larger size to sink enough current. So the way I did, first input carry and first P1 in the first vertical line, this line, and the output is, we can know the output of this is C2 or C, whatever it is, C1 for example, which is PCI plus G. So every time I am, what function I am implementing? G plus PCI, okay, G plus PCI. So I say this is PCI, series to that is G. So put immediately P2 for this, go above, put G3 on this, keep doing. But you can see here also for every one of them, if you see the path, actually it is series connected. By showing you 4 lines, I tried to show you as if there are only 2 in series, 2 in series, 2 in series. But in real life, for the last one, the path is this. The only thing is, since I have already evaluated them before I reach there, sometime I am trying to save by combining them. Okay, but essentially larger end will require larger time, even if look ahead people feel there is no carry propagation. Okay, even then there is a propagation going on, because I mean speed is not improving so much as we thought had to be. Also, each output of G from where it is coming, where the final fan out capability may require larger transistors also. Larger fan in will require improve or rather increase the logical effort. Larger fan out will require larger speed down there also. So in some sense, the look ahead which came out with such a bang, saying that, oh, I have now fastest adder with me, did not prove to be as good when I really implemented it. But we will not leave it. Say, okay, here is another possibility. We say delay is proportional to n in the case of look ahead. If we do the operation which I showed, instead I make it a block decisions. Okay, I say, okay, I will make a block of 2 or 4 or something. I do one calculation for something which is faster than some other, and then for each of them, and then propagate in between them. Okay, this is what I am saying. I did broke into parts A0, A1, A2, A3 as this. I perform operations for 4 blocks, and then again 2 block, and then this block. This essentially is like a tree, and one can will show you that then the delay is proportional to log of n to the base 2. Essentially what we did, if you have 16 bit numbers, 2 to the power 4 is n. So I need to calculate only 4 such positions the delay, and I will be able to then calculate the delay directly. This is the method. Now what we did, okay, maybe there are different kinds of look ahead carry available. One is called ripple block carry look ahead. What we did, we make blocks. Right now I showed only 2 blocks. So blocks of 2 bits, 4 bits kind of thing. So in a block, I use look ahead. In a block, I calculate delays, because I know for n lower, it will be faster. So I use n lower, and I calculated the delay using look aheads. Okay. But between the blocks, I actually rippled. Okay. Between the blocks, because then if n increases, I know it is not very, so I rippled it. So this ripple block carry look ahead adder, the idea of the ripple block carry adder addition is lessen the fan in, because then you don't have to put larger inputs, smaller inputs, okay, and lower fan out difficulties. A ripple block carry look ahead adder consists of n m bit blocks arranged in such a way that carries within blocks are generated by carry look ahead, but between the blocks I ripple it. That's what I said, I just read again. The block side m is normally fixed no more than 4, because otherwise logical effort will be very high. Okay, So we normally don't exceed m more than 4. If you do that, then it can be grouped in a 4, and then any number can be done, and it will be log of that, those points can be obtained on that. This essentially is called dot operators, you know. For example, a parallel prefix adders are constructed out of fundamental carry operator, which is called dot operator C. So if you have a G double dash P double dash, then it has a dot product with G dash P dash. This is a group of G and P. So instead of G1, we say G1, GI PI is one block, GI plus 1 PI one another. I keep blocks in my design. And if I make a dot product, the dot product of this essentially is G double dash P prime P double prime. Using this, maybe even better figure can be shown. This is essentially a dot operator, okay. As I say, time permitting, otherwise we can explain. So I can now work on a block design. Here we are, I can go for look ahead, and block to block I will ripple anyway. And using this concept, as I say, the many adders have been published. One is called Cog Stone, then this Kung's tree, Wallace tree, many trees which you see essentially are doing this. What they do, this is a block of 2 for example, and each is now transferring to the next level by ripple. Here another one for 16, this is the 64 bits. You can see the way I have shown. This is a block of 4, block of 4, block of 4, and then they transfer as a 1 to the next block. Okay. Take a block 4, transfer to the next as 1 carry. Okay, and keep using for next. So 4, then next 4, then 4. You can see then I am going logarithmic way, and therefore I can speed up my operation in the look ahead carry. So look ahead carry is never used in a normal way. If at all, it will be one of the 6 or 8 trees which are available. Last part, we can also do much of this hardware using dominoes, because that has an advantage of less number of transistors. However, you require a keeper, this inverter which is a weak P. You need this block to keep this circuit not trying to go out of the logic, okay. This is called keeper. So you can have a generate propagate on a domino. You can also have a, sorry, same figure has come. Then you can use both of them to create your domino sum, okay. The last part, quickly I'll say, it's a carry save adder. The carry save adder is essentially a serial adder. Carry save adder is called is a serial adder, because if you see your earlier figure which I have shown on serial adder, what was serial adder was doing? That you input the data agent from somewhere, and the way it happens, it takes the last carry, adds with this, finds a sum and recirculates back through a register. Now that fact that it recirculates that back essentially is a serial adder. Carry save registers both carry and sum together. That is what serial adder did. It's register sum and registers carry. That's why these are called carry save. These adders, why I am showing you, because I talk so much on DSP, these are the ones which probably you will use mostly in a DSP applications. The way it is done, there is a sign input, there is a carry input. First A input is added here and then transferred to the, so this part has two layers, one can say, which is delayed by registers here. So this operation is performed and passed through registers, okay, to the next block where B input appears, and then final sum is carried out parallelly. So the first block is called carry save adding, and the second block to get full sum is parallel adder, is a parallel adder. So did I tell you initially that never work for serial or parallel? Try with serial parallel. In case of DSP, a serial parallel adder is very important for saving time as well as power, and therefore these are very important. As I said, time, otherwise we would have discussed much more details. Just to give an idea, a typical carry, this carry propagate adder which is shown here, the way it is, A0, A1, A2, A3 are shown as the inputs here. So the way it happens, the first addition is performed, and it is delayed 3 clocks, okay. But the output of this carry is through a register is given to the next stage. The output of this carry is given through another register, another delay to the third stage. Output of this carry is given through another this. And since this carry must wait, because it will take 3 cycles to come here, I will delay my last input by 3 cycles, because that carry will take 3 cycles to reach to my this place. You can see, 1, 2, 3 delays to come here. So I actually, for A3, I actually delayed it by 3 clocks so that it actually coincides and I get the new sum. This essentially is, it is used in a DSP because it, of course it has a very, DSP does not bother too much on latency, but they want outputs. So you have multi, large outputs you can create. You can fill the flip-flops, okay, by data. You can serially keep coming the data. It will move in a clock cycle. As after 3 clock cycle, this will be operating, after 2, this will be operating, after 1, this will be operating. Now the data is keep coming, and since it is keep coming, you are, it's like pipeline, pipeline is full, the latency is k plus 3. K is the time for addition per cycle. So actually latency has increased, but the throughput is very high. Okay. And speed is not governed because speed is now decided by the clock. Okay, decided by the clock. So these are essentially pipeline adder. This is that Nora implementation. Nora is essentially domino, some extent, or zipper, in which N channel device or block is followed by a P channel. NP. Okay. So if this is P, the next is N. Okay. It's called NP or Nora. Okay. So this is essentially only 2 bits shown here. There is another adder which is called conditional sum adder. What we are doing, using a pass gate, I can create S0, S1, C0, C1, and these are functions are called generate. S0 is my XNOR, S1 is XOR, C0 is A dot B, C1 is A plus B. So all 4 functions I can create. Then what I do, this cell I call is a conditional cell in which I can create all 4, and depending on actual carry, I'll output the sum. Okay. It's conditional. What carry? Put that output. Okay. So essentially by you can connect actual outputs depending on switches. You can put this, you can put this. So I can decide whether carry is 0, I'll go up, carry 1, I'll go down. Okay. So this is called conditional sum. It is used in many applications for saving actually hardware. Okay, we'll quit this. I was just trying to show you that all adders find the maximum use in multipliers. These are some of the multipliers. This you can try. This is the easiest multiplier which uses some kind of serial business and parallel adding. Okay, you are inputting data serially but using addition parallelly. This is called shift add type of multiplier. Easiest to implement, of course not very fast. For fast multipliers, you need arrays, you need lot of half adders, full adders, you know, and the kind of times you need to know. So there are different kinds of multipliers to show you, which will improve the speed. Booth, of course, is the best among them. But everyone is using adders. All that I am trying to show you that they are using adders. Okay. Huge adder blocks. So if you have a 64-bit adder, this is unit, then you can see carry bypass will give 0.27, carry select will get 0.27, carry lookahead will get 0.15, provided it is logarithmic kind. Okay. And this is the graph for that. Different adders I used for different n. You can see static, highest, mirror, Manchester, bypass, select. Depends on the bit size, you can make a decisions. Okay. Same numbers are used in the multiplier, and this is the decision for multiplier. Final. I thank Mr. Rewe Chandrakasan Nikolic for their effort in explaining the arithmetic in their book, which is chapter 13, Digital Integrated Circuits. Of course, to my students who made many of my transparencies, which I did not show, fortunately. Except one, I did not show many of my transparencies. Many postgraduate students, which I keep saying, I learned much of my hardware and software of course, I don't know, from my students. If Anand, who sits in my class, asks me a question, then I think. And maybe that time I say, I don't know, but next day I'll say, oh, this is how it is. So I think I am helped by my students. Most of us are. So that's a catchword. If you don't know a subject, teach it. Okay. Because when you teach, you learn. Okay. And finally, thank you all for patient listening, and I hope that something you learned here was worth spending time at IIT Bombay. These are the references. Please take it. This is just to show you, whenever you use others this kind of statement is adapted from UCB course site, which is a copyright of Professor Ribby, from and also from the book, which is Prentice Hall 2003 edition, also from Schrangian and West, also from, for DSP, anyone interested, Professor Sharma teaches times those course, system design. We use a book which is written by Indian, Vijay K. Mendisetti, which is VLSI digital signal. Most of the DSP part has been picked up from this book, and also of course some arithmetic part I picked up from compiler arithmetic, very old book, Wang's book. Okay, and so when my students were working, we looked into many of this. These are essentially the four books which this particular part was using. There are many good books other than this, but these are something which particularly slides of mine and talk of mine has compiled through. Okay. So please, as I say, most teachers use slides from anywhere, it doesn't matter. As long as you are not selling, it's allowed, but first specify everywhere, on every transparency APPT if possible, whose index is there, or at least write. Of course, this they expect this first line to be at the first. Okay. They expect we start with this, adapted from this, and then show any slide. Okay. So in case you are doing this, please do this. Otherwise, you are violating Copyright Act. Okay, and you are punishable. Okay. Of course, it's very difficult for Americans to come and sue you here. So it's okay. So you can get away. Thank you very much.